will call the meeting to order. The meeting is being taped by FCAT, the Frontier Community Access Television Station, and will be available for residents to view shortly, on demand. Okay, first items on the agenda, we have meeting minutes for September 19th. Has everybody reviewed those minutes?
Yeah.
Any changes or additions? No?
Good thing.
Okay, they look good. I'll make a motion that we accept the minutes for September 19th. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
We also have meeting minutes for September 26th. Has everybody reviewed those minutes?
Yeah.
Right, any changes or additions? Yeah. All right, I'll make a motion that we approve the minutes for September 26th. Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay. Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
All right, we have three warrants. We have a vendor warrant for $386,984. We have a payroll warrant of $95,536. And we have a payroll deduction warrant of $24,933. I'll make a motion that we approve those warrants. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. All right, next item on the agenda, meetings attended by select board members.
I have a few. One of them, not a select board member, but I don't know if anyone went to the Conway Historical Society, but Phil Cantor gave a really great talk on the attempted robbing the Conway Bank back in about 1885.
That was his building.
And that was right here, and the attempt was to break into that very safe, and anyone who didn't hear it missed a good talk. So.
Okay.
And there was a clean energy conference last Thursday at UMass I went to, and you know, and it was great to go and see all the stuff that's going on in all the towns about various kinds of clean energy, mm-hmm. Converting boilers to burning wood pellets and that actually burn very clean and are renewable. And anyway, a lot going on, so that was mm-hmm. excellent.
Okay.
And then,
okay. Bob, you have any? Also, last Thursday, Bob and I were at the Hampshire County Select Boards Association meeting, and there was a very good presentation by the USDA on all the programs they have, and I collected a lot of information for that that I'm going to pass along to Tom. They seem to, even though they have agriculture in their name, they do a lot more than agriculture. So that was pretty interesting.
One other meeting that was this week was the Energy Committee had a meeting on their solar program of building an array for the town mm-hmm. and looking at various proposals of how to build it and how to pay for it. And they were really just looking for feedback from the Finance Committee, Planning Board, Select Board. And another, we're going to have another meeting, little like all meetings, open to the public, mm-hmm. with the group that the subcontractor they've hired. To come to talk to them about what we want to do.
Okay, great. Friday morning I attended the legislative breakfast in Amherst, which was sponsored by the Massachusetts Municipal Association. They had some very good information on updates in terms of legislation. And they've taken a position on both of the ballot votes for November. The marijuana vote and the charter school vote, and their position is no on both. So that was kind of interesting. Mm-hmm. They went to a long explanation about the charter schools. There was a lot of discussion on it about how it does drain money from the public schools, even though the ads you see on TV say it doesn't.
Right.
And there were, I won't name the legislators who were there, who basically said, yeah, that's true, it does drain money from public schools, so, you know, mm-hmm. that was interesting. So both of those meetings were very very informative. And we have any citizens' concerns?
I had one citizen's concern brought to me this week about the work they're supposed to be doing at the town hall, the brick facing on the outside of the town hall. And they said they were very concerned. Tom, you probably were at these meetings, so you're going to lighten this a little better. This person said that they told them that when they start gluing the stuff to the outside wall, that for 10 days after it's glued on, the temperature shouldn't drop below 40 degrees.
I think that's quite an overestimate. I heard that it could cure in a day afterward.
Okay. Well, they were concerned so that with the upcoming depends. Temperatures, it wasn't going to stay above 40 at night.
Well, the contractor is well aware of the situation and the temperature requirements of the materials.
He was just concerned that they weren't going to put them on and have them fall off after that. That's all this guy was concerned about.
Okay. Anything else? Okay. Next item on the agenda is the ambulance department proposal for prepayment of EMS training. You guys are up. What's your proposal?
Well, I did a very brief kind of outline of what we're thinking. Just in the past, the ambulance has paid upfront for people to get training, and it's come back basically to bite us in the butt as far as not either people not passing the course or not giving any service back to the town, and then either not paying the money back or it's been an argument to get the money back. Mm-hmm. And there's some people, I don't even know if the money has ever been recouped from them or not, because that was before I took over as director. So I don't know whatever happened with it. And at this point, you guys probably have already figured out that we're a little bit short on EMTs. And I've had at least two people tell me that they don't have the money up front to put down for the amount that the class costs and the licenses and everything, but they would be willing to take the class if it was paid for in advance.
How much is the class?
It can range depending on where they go to get the classroom.
Yeah. There's a couple of different places that offer
upwards
it.
Upwards of around $1,000.
Rough, yeah, it's in the ballpark of $1,000, maybe a little more, a little less, depending on which place they go to get the classing.
Okay, and then there's a license fee after that?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep. I think the state exam, of course, costs some money to test.
The licensing fees in some places, one institute that offers it, the licensing fees are all included in, it's one cost for the class, the training, and the licensing. Through like GCC, it's all separate. You have to pay it individually.
How many EMTs do we have now?
Currently, we have five.
How many do we need?
More.
Yeah.
So people are willing to do it.
It's very hard to say how many you need. The more, the better.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, if we could ballpark to get say five more,
that would be
That would be a good start. To at least spread it out a little bit between everybody and,
Okay, right now you have two people that you think would be good at it if they took the class and they became licensed.
Yes.
Just that it's a financial problem.
Correct.
Okay.
And, I think if the option was available so that people didn't have to put the money out up front, mm-hmm. I think there might be more people that would be willing to consider it.
Okay. How are we going to obligate people once we've paid that fee?
Well, that's where you guys would come, where we would like your help as to how we go about this, so that there's a little more weight behind any kind of, mm-hmm. we come up with some kind of contract and get you guys' help with that, because Chris and I don't know how to,
Okay. Why don't you work with Gemma and Jack Fitzgibbons, come up with a contract, a simple one page, that a potential EMT candidate would sign for us, so that...
It would stand up in small claims court if it had to.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And that way, if we have people that are worthy of that upfront payment and they stay with us, that's fine. If they're doing it just to do it and then,
correct,
not fulfill their responsibilities, then we have some recourse. Okay, so...
How would this be funded?
That's another question, is whether or not would we try to, and maybe that's for another day, or we come up with a plan first. I don't know if we would want a separate account or a separate fund that was specifically for EMT training. Currently, we have in the ambulance budget, there is an account for trainings that at this point is mostly used towards recertification fees and, you know, general, the upkeep of current EMTs to keep their licenses with Con Ed classes and relicensing. Not as much for new EMTs in a lump sum. Mm-hmm. Currently, what we've been doing is repaying licensing and classroom fees to EMTs in an installment of, you know, three payments over a year, I think, is what mm-hmm. we've been doing.
Yeah, for a new EMT.
For new EMTs.
As they meet certain thresholds, they get
as big a chunk of money at one time. So it...
So they weren't getting it all back in one day.
No.
That might be a problem where you're not signing up then. Could be. I mean...
All right. Between now and the next budget, Tom, why don't we see if we can get some money out of the reserve fund to finance our EMT training, and then we'll come up with an estimate in the next budget for what we might need on an annual basis mm-hmm. for that training.
Okay. Okay.
That would be an application to the finance committee, and I can help with that.
Okay.
You talk about bonuses and educational bonuses for the EMTs that you have, I guess, probably in the future and the ones that you have on board now.
Yeah.
Do you have an account for that now set up? Or
it's not a specific account. It's done, I think, I'm still figuring all this out with mm-hmm. my directorship business. Mm-hmm. My understanding when I was talking to Jody before I took over was that when she does the budget for the following year, she looks at how many EMTs would be recertifying and then counts in what their bonus would be along with the recertification fees, and that gets counted in, I believe it's in the educational account budget.
Yeah, how it goes, Chris?
I believe so.
I think.
Yeah, it all usually goes as one check. Their $250 and their relicensing fee reimbursement all comes at once, but I believe it comes at two different line items.
I think it's two different.
What's the bonuses usually?
Bonus is usually $250, mm-hmm. and that's every 2 years. Covers the cost of driving to classes.
Oh my God, they have a lot of classes to go to, sorry.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, we have, now with the new licensing, we have to have 48 hours of continuing ed credits.
Mm-hmm. Is that a year or 3 years?
2 years.
Every 2 years.
Well, that's still a lot.
It's
dedication.
Mm-hmm. Quite a bit of time. And most of the classes are held in Greenfield or Shelburne. There's not really anything.
All right, so your immediate need is for two more right now. So let's
at least that would be nice, you know, and if we okay. could
how many would you want?
We'd like right to now? See
I would like
another
people.
Five.
Yeah. Another five.
Okay.
Right. I think would be excellent if we could within the next say maybe even the next year try to get. Obviously, the classes take time, so it's not mm-hmm. like we can get anybody licensed within
we may have to
a month.
This
but
gets all put together, the package. You may have to try to somehow educate the public of this. Yeah. So there may be somebody out in the wings that were interested, but they just didn't want to
correct mm-hmm.
dedicate themselves with their own money at the time. And
right.
Sitting back there, not saying nothing to nobody. They might be willing to join them, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, how long is the course?
Once again, it depends. If you take it at GCC, it's a semester. If you take mm-hmm. what they call an impact class, I think there's one running in Amherst, it's under a month.
Yeah, it's like...
But you're there
all the time.
Six days a week and mm-hmm. all day. So that one is hard for anybody that works
right.
full time.
Right.
There are a couple of people that have talked about when their summer, they get laid off in the winter and maybe they'd be able to take a class in the winter.
Okay. Obviously, our need for EMTs is critical, and it looks like we have a critical shortage at this point. Do we have any other questions for Jen or Chris?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Is the proposal that I made to Tom reasonable?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. Then let's. I'll make a motion that we approve providing fees up front for class and licensing based on a contract that we'll work out with our town council for some obligatory obligation for our EMTs that we pay this up front for. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Thank you, guys. You guys do a great job, by the way.
Thank you.
And, we certainly need to have EMTs, more than five EMTs.
Good job.
Nice.
Good job, Chris.
I'll be in touch. We'll figure out.
All right, next item on our agenda is the Open Space Committee proposal for preferring low input agriculture on town land. Michelle, is that you?
I guess so, yeah.
Okay.
So, at our last...
It's easier for the camera.
Oh, sure. At our last meeting, the Open Space Committee asked me to inquire of Nick Miller, who is the director of the project out there.
He's the fluvial geomorphologist.
So to ask him what agricultural activity would be appropriate in the lowered floodplain, because it was apparent that it was a much more gradual slope than we had imagined from previous descriptions, and looked possible to, you know, run a tractor through there.
Mm-hmm.
And so we just wanted to find out from one of the experts involved,
mm-hmm,
what would be appropriate. And he passed my inquiry on to FERCOG, Kimberly McPhee, Noah, mm-hmm, McPhee, who replied, copying Tom and me and Nick and Janet, who's the chair of the Open Space Committee. Basically she said, should I just read her correspondence?
Sure,
I don't know if you guys have seen it.
No.
Hello, Janet. Tom H. and I discussed this when we had a site visit last week. This was written on September 29th. One of the concerns I have is disturbing the recently planted floodplain area now and in the future. The environmental permits for the project assume that the reconnected floodplain area is planted with native vegetation and is functioning as a component of the river restoration project. I'm not sure what the NHESP, Natural Heritage, right?
Yep.
Folks would think about plowing under the recently seeded area and planting hay or allowing livestock access. I had proposed different possible levels of, you know, what if it was in corn, what if it was grazed, blah, blah, blah. So she says, allowing access in the area that's been seeded with native vegetation as part of the restoration effort, they would probably not be happy, and I don't think DEP would be happy either. Remember, we use less than 1 acre of the 11-acre parcel. So there's plenty of land left for farming, if that's what the town wants to do with the property. I'm not clear, and then this you put in bold, I'm not clear about whether or not the farmer wants to hay the project area, but I think it's problematic to allow any disturbance, planting hay, plant with crops, grazing, of the floodplain lowering area now or in the future. I think it's wise to have a buffer area around the floodplain bowl so that the agricultural activities don't creep into the restoration area. I think concerns about the use of pesticides and fertilizers are warranted, but I'm not an expert in this area. The Greenfield Office of the NRCS may have some good recommendations, and Lori Sanders may also be able to weigh in on this. Thank you, Kimberly. So, given...
Right. So Open Space is just concerned about that 1 acre?
Yeah, the lowered part.
The lowered part.
Okay. I mean, long term, I think we need to consider maintenance of the entire area.
Sure.
But at this point because we're really excited that Gary has stepped up and wants to hay the field, which is great, you know?
I'm concerned about that 1 acre parcel eventually growing up the brush with nothing done with it.
Yes, exactly. So what we need to find out from whoever has the vision for, you know, how this is supposed to work, can it be brush hogged once a year? You know, what, just that lowered part. If Kimberly is of the opinion that it shouldn't be mowed like for hay, what would be appropriate? And, you know, I don't particularly have...
With? Well, I did speak with Gary about this, and he does have replies to these points, if he could.
Okay, which is great. So, and I'd love to hear them, Mike. I'm just kind of, at this point...
Actually, there's a chair over there for him.
I'd be really interested to hear what Gary recommends. And then...
So Gary has heard the concerns of the Open Space Committee.
Well,
right?
You just heard the letter, but I don't know from him.
And I communicated the essentials of that to him, and he had answers for the concerns that were, that were written down.
Go ahead, Gary.
Okay, so what I was planning to do was, first off, and I actually did this afternoon, I rotary mowed down all that crap that had grown up there, all the brush and you know, goldenrod and all that
this
stuff.
This is in a regular field there?
From the whole...
Yeah, where Ron Boyden had...
Yep, corn.
Except when I very first started in, it all looked like the same. And I was a little higher than I should have been because I went along and I was on a clunk on a big rock and down. You know, you just couldn't see what you were getting into there. And so pretty quickly I realized, okay, I'm a little too far towards the road here. But I cleared that off anyway so I could really see what was what. And so I know there was there's some wetland on that side where it goes down. And after mowing it off, now I can see where the edge of that is, where I didn't know where it was with it all grown up. So my plan is to plow that area and harrow it up and seed it down. And you know, not touch the area that's hydro seeded.
Yeah, yeah. And there's next to the hydro seeded area, there's stuff that they had thrown grass, so you know, straw over.
Right, I got.
But I think that's part of not the project.
Right,
right,
right. That's cleaning up where, like, they had that giant mound of dirt.
Yes,
you know, the topsoil that they piled
over those two
and
areas.
Things like that.
So that can be reseeded there.
Yeah. So I have actually a question for you guys, because it should be in the contract with Davenport. What seed is in that hydro seed? What is it?
Yeah, I can get that for you. There are 8 or 10 kinds of grass in there.
Okay, and did they put seed down under the hay that they chopped and blew around?
I don't know that. I think the hay is left over from the bales.
Right, but did they just chop it and blow it, or did they put seed under it? That's
it looked like
important
from
for me to
from
know.
Walking around
that's where you're going to plow.
Yeah.
Well, part of the problem is it's hard to plowing likes to be in pretty straight lines,
right?
So what they've got, like for example, where their big dirt pile was, is like a big circle
in the
that
field.
I would need to go straight across and put that in, you know, with and just physically to do it reasonably. And at the far end also, they've got a thing coming in that I would want to go straight across.
And that's covered with the hay.
I think that's covered because it was loose soil that was a result of them working in the area.
Exactly.
And they had their tractors driving.
So, but there would be, like, I don't need to go right up tight, plowing right to the edge of where it slopes over. But so if I knew what was going to come up there, that would be helpful. to know what they, if they put seed down.
Yeah, it looked to me when I was watching them do it that they kind of peters out. Like they sprayed it really thick in the part that looks green, and in the part where it's straw, like because I was walking around out there, there's a little bit of hydro seeding and then it fades out.
Right, it's just under the straw where there's no hydro seeding.
It's not very
I'd like to
far.
Know if there is seed under
there it. Is some in places. But the other thing is, as part of, I think even what Tom had initially written up, that the volunteers keep a path mowed around the field.
Right, Jack Locke mows that around.
Yeah, well, so. I do it when he's away.
Oh, you do it when he's away, okay.
It's a nice thing.
But anyway, it would go, I guess, along the bank, at the top of that bank, the dip.
Oh, it wouldn't go down along by the river?
I don't think so, because we can't mow in that area. I think it's going to go basically around the perimeter of the Hable stuff.
Here's the thing is, that's going to get established before winter. And next year, that'll just grow right up.
Right.
And you would be able to mow that right around.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
Are you not allowed to mow?
That's what I'm concerned about, is can we put our path through the depressed area?
See, I don't know why not.
Right.
You know.
Right.
Right now, I think somebody, I'm not qualified to answer that question.
I don't
see
why you wouldn't be able to.
I was assuming we needed to go the perimeter of the...
And I want to address your also those concerns about... See, I would want to hay on that lower part also. What I was talking to Tom about and about to Jack Gates was, you know, and it's all in here too if
no,
I sign
saw
this.
I just saw this,
right,
the new version.
That I wouldn't be touching that this coming year.
Yeah.
But it does need to be mowed this coming year or it does grow up poorly, right? Even that. So there's really, whether you're mowing it with a disc bind and taking hay off or rotary mowing it, either way you're mowing it and you're driving on it, right? So what I think is probably going to happen with that hydro seeding is it's probably going to be grasses, and I don't know this for sure because I don't know exactly what's in it, but they're probably going to maybe grow up something like this, right? You know, it's probably perennial rye, maybe some really grass.
Conservation mix of some sort.
Those types of things, right? Not a production thing.
Right.
So what I would propose to do would be to come in with a no-till drill, a no-till seeder that doesn't disturb the soil, and go over after mowing down what's there. Like, for example, I did this on my own. I did it on Bill Graves's, where you come in after you've mowed, say second cutting, say in August or September, and you come in with a no-till drill and you overseed that. And those types of grasses don't overwhelm that new seed grass. Will
so
come
next,
up.
Next summer you would do that.
Right, that would, like a year from, this last, September probably would be the optimal time.
And you wouldn't mind having those other grasses in the mix that you're going to hay.
Right, yeah. And I would want to probably next summer, if it comes up good, take that off as well as hay. Drive through there and take what is there.
Right.
Because that keeps it clean and not growing weeds. And, you know, every time you leave something, well, you see what the field's what it was now, right? You know. When you don't do something, good stuff doesn't happen to it, just bad.
Bad stuff comes in quick.
Yeah.
And when you hay, it's cutting the plant off so that the roots remain in it. We're not talking about disturbing the soil during harvest either.
That's right.
Which is one reason the Open Space Committee was happy to have it hayed instead of in corn.
Corn, right.
Yeah. Yeah, because that soil is going to be held all the time.
Right.
Yeah. And the field is a very well-drained field. And that's really one reason why I'm into, you know, it's flat, it's nice, it's well drained, it's not stony. It's a really good field for me to be interested in. I'm sorry?
Except for that rock you drove.
Well, yeah, but that I was a field there.
Oh, were you on that? The town side of the entry?
No,
road?
No, but
there's some big rocks over there, yeah.
Yeah.
Up towards where the
it was more towards the road,
yeah.
For example,
yeah,
than I should have started in.
Mm. So
I was being a little
to?
Optimistic when I first started, and I went, oh, this isn't going to work here.
This is a natural heritage question?
Well, no. That's
I know,
my
Ken
question
Gary
is that...
Pay that?
Yeah.
That 1 acre? Or
well,
Kimberly seems to be saying it shouldn't be.
It gives us like 3/4 of a year to come up with the answer for
that. That's true. I just, as we're writing an agreement now, I just wanted to raise that concern. Mm-hmm. It's like, it's not that, I'm not saying I personally or that even the committee has an objection. We only are raising the concern because of what their intention was in planting that area.
What are you planting in there in the regular field?
Orchard grass.
Orchard grass.
It's going to be straight orchard grass. Because with it being a well-drained field, my intention would be to come right in there early, like in June, like I did. The first field I mowed this year was Russ French's up there at Norm's place, across from the covered bridge. And I feel like if I'm going to come all the way to do that, this is a natural fit logistically for me to do the two at the same time.
So do you harvest the hay once a year or do you do twice?
I do at least twice. For sure, everything twice. Usually I don't get third cutting normally is just at home on my own or on Graves's that's close by. Generally we don't, but if there was a lot of third on there, I'd probably want to come take it off. And then it also then that goes to I'd need to be able to fertilize it. I don't have manure to put on it anymore like I used to with John Holy's cows being gone. So I have to buy commercial fertilizer now to.
But we don't have a commitment to organic or anything like that, right? I mean, I don't think so. I think it's fine.
Yeah. And I guess the other thing, and this is probably less likely, but it's possible that some of those weeds could come back up through, and I might want to spray a broadleaf killer on there to take them out if they're bad enough. Because otherwise, then it's not worth it for me to
hay it, right?
to get it if it's just going to be rubbish. So,
you mean on the whole 10 acres, or you're now thinking about the 1 acre?
Not that, because it wouldn't happen on that, because that
they've taken care of that.
Yeah, everything.
It would be on where I rode and mowed today.
Okay,
the upper part only.
Yeah.
There's a chance because it's going to be a quick turnover. I would want to have a plow in the field tomorrow. And
because the time of year it is, right?
Yeah, I mean time is really short. I would have preferred to be doing this 2 weeks ago whatever, but it's the window is closing fast. I can still do it, but I got to do it really fast.
Right. Are you aware? And you may not be. Next June 15th,
yes.
16th, 17th, 18th.
Yes.
We want to use the center of that field.
For parking for the 250?
No, for fireworks.
Oh, fireworks. Yes, Tom told me.
And hopefully the best result for would be, I would think, is if you had it mowed prior to that. That would
right.
when you mow.
Right. That would be critical. I talked to Tom about that. That
I could show
him
a fire marshal once.
Well,
there wasn't a bunch of dry grass standing.
Yeah. Well, that would be a problem.
Yeah.
That's a next door neighbor.
What?
Right. Exactly.
Do you know the days of the...
The fireworks will be on the Friday night of, 16th?
16th.
Okay.
It's 16th what, 15th, 16th, 17th?
That should work.
June.
That should work out really well, actually.
That is 16th.
Yeah.
Friday night.
As long as it's not raining. Nice
well,
too much.
Yeah. Barring rain constantly from June 1 to that day, there should be
what
a three-day gap.
What they
gap
do, Gary,
in there
is the fireworks company goes in, mark off the spot where they're going to shoot the fireworks off, and they have to put a perimeter fence, just a temporary, one-day perimeter fence up.
Yeah.
It's a federal, state and federal law that it has to be fenced off with this snow fence type stuff.
Sure.
People stay the hell out of there while they're shooting it off.
Well,
And they shoot it off on Friday night, do a normal inspection of the property after the fireworks show is over, make sure there's no unfired stuff. Mm-hmm. Then they have to come back the next morning at daylight, and they have to reinspect the whole area again.
Yeah.
And then they pull up the fence and they're gone.
Yeah.
No unexploded
ordnance. No. Bad problems in the past. If somebody came in with a lawnmower after they didn't see one,
ooh,
and it went off and the lawnmower hit it.
Ooh.
Wow. So it wasn't pretty.
So is there a way we can move forward with the current plan for the next year while not deciding finally on what happens with the acre during future years?
I don't think there's a problem with that.
Would you be willing to still undertake doing it?
If I could
even
use
that
lower part?
Yeah. I just don't know what they're going to say.
But
it was the 1 acre really like right in the middle?
It's on the side, but
it means
the slope in is nice and gradual.
Yeah. It is very gradual.
It would be very easily I would mow it like it wasn't even there.
Yeah.
I would just,
you
know. But then you've got those kind of the mounds built up around the trees near the river, and there's spaces for the water to come in between. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't go in there at all.
Yeah,
I would stay on the field side of those tree mounds and just straight line.
From the discussions I've had, they want to encourage native, like, I don't know who's going to do all this work, volunteers? But, already in some of those places, I was out there today, like the bittersweet and not the honeysuckles coming back up, but there's still knotweed in places and stuff. So that area's going to need attention, but if some brush grows in, it'd be important in trees as well, in that whole river. The river needs some stuff there, but the water could still go through. I don't think they intend to mow it right up to the edge.
No, that's not Gary's intent.
I wouldn't.
Yeah, no, and I don't think they want that. But we need to.
Personally,
I guess what I'm.
Any problems with what you're talking? As long as we get the answers you were looking for, and in the spring you do the no-till.
Next fall.
But you don't have anything. You can go in there tomorrow. You don't have any questions for your immediate planting and plowing.
Right.
You're going to stay away from that one later.
Except that I'm mowing the acre.
And that you can see where the existing path is.
Yes.
And
yes.
That we would like to keep, correct?
Right.
Where we have the input from you guys to keep the path going around
but
the
field. But whether the path can go through the 1 acre.
Where it goes around, I don't know that part.
Yes,
but you shouldn't get too close to the edge anyway, of the slope with your plowing.
His orchard grass, he's going to plant, even if he got it in where you're
we can mow right over it again.
Nothing.
But
yeah.
We want
to be a little path.
I know that path gets a lot easier.
Just a little language to this.
Well, that's good. That's good that it's useful. Let's
see what that looks like to you.
Okay, it's in paragraph 1B, the last part of it that says, and contingent on further approval. That's what we've added to that, and contingent on further approval.
Oh, I see the difference.
Yeah. All right?
Yeah.
Is that agreeable with everyone?
With the understanding that contingent approval could involve natural heritage or whoever it needs to involve in order to see that it's an appropriate use of the land.
So, how will I? Will you guys tell me?
Well, yeah, we'll get.
Well, that wouldn't be till next year anyway.
Should we find out back when you said you were going to do it in the fall? next year?
I was going to...
No pill. Staple those.
And that'll also give me time to see what actually grows up there.
Yeah.
And, you know, what does it do? And, if it does what I suspect it's going to do, then it would be nice to oversee.
Next summer we should get you the answers before fall rolls around.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that'd be great. Until then, is it okay next summer if I drive through and mow and bale what does come up there? Is that a problem?
Next summer?
Yeah.
I don't think it should be.
Oh, that's right. It's in this.
I'll get back to you on that.
But you will have to.
Somebody's obviously gonna have to, but until we have an answer, I didn't say not next year.
Yeah,
because I just think we need to ask them what maintenance should go on there, because it needs to go on there. Because even if they don't want it, hey, it would need to be mowed once a year to keep it from turning into filling up with trees. It would be poplar in like 2 years. They were starting to come up in the middle of the field already.
Yeah.
All right, so basically we don't have anything to worry about next summer, correct?
But, right. But you also mentioned spring, herbicide.
I wanted to know if it's okay to do that, if it's something I feel like needs to be done.
So is
that going to be a problem?
This would be a spot herbiciding or whole field herbiciding?
Well, depending on
what it looks like.
Comes up.
Yeah, because you can, like, for example, this last spring, starting last fall, I had a real problem with dockweed on an area that I had reseeded on our own, about 13 acres, two or three years ago. And it came up last year on third cutting, just all over the place. But it was also at the old Harris Field, mm-hmm. where it floods right at the base of that mm-hmm. hill. I don't know if you remember driving by and you see like weeds that area, right? And they kept going further and further. So when I had crop production in this last spring to take care of the dockweed at home, I said, I want to add, I had them bring enough for another acre and go in and take that stuff out at that base. So that was a selective thing, not just like over everything.
Yeah.
But it's a big rig with like an 80-foot boom on it, so it does cover a big area, but they can also shut some of it. They don't have to have it the whole thing going at once.
So would Natural Heritage object to that,
We don't know.
We have to ask if they would in the lowered area, of course.
Yeah. Well, you're not talking about the lowered area.
No. Yeah.
The other area, right. They just said, what did they say?
They say about that upper area.
That, right, okay, good.
Yeah,
totally. Use of pesticides and fertilizers are warranted, but I'm not an expert. Ask NRCS.
I don't have a problem with that. You, John?
This is the list of seed that they put in.
They've been doing it for... the last 3 years when it was in corn, a lot of stuff went on it.
A lot.
But it's being careful mix, about. Huh?
I guess it is.
Oh, that's the mix.
This is the mix that's in. Okay, so
they're native wild grasses.
27, boy, that's 1% autumn bent grass, whatever that is. It's mostly, this is in descending order. Right. Yeah. Creeping red fescue. The fescue that's good to harvest is a tall endophyte-free fescue. I doubt that's endophyte-free, but I don't know. No. I'd have to ask Mike Barlow.
I'm sure Kimberly could put you in touch with the people who made up that list.
So who's going to get the answers?
That's a good question
Probably me.
It's going to be you or Michelle. I don't know. So
probably
or Janet. So
Tom's going to have to leave.
Okay, great.
Plenty of time, and I'm sure Kimberly can help on that as well.
Yeah, we'll be asking. We'll keep. Our interest will be maintained. So,
basically, that's good. Not much of this.
Allowing him to put that
is what I'd be looking
worth it,
for.
Yeah.
If he
yeah.
needs need to.
Yeah.
How long will that last if you oversee them?
This stuff?
Yeah.
It'll stay there.
It will.
Yeah, it'll stay there. But orchard grass is, that will take over on some other stuff.
Because it grows tall and
yeah, it can. It's a pretty dominating species.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I don't know why they pick these particular ones, if it's for the root systems and erosion control or what.
I'm sure it has a lot to do with that.
That's what we could find out.
He probably figured that maybe nothing was ever going to be done with that.
Right. And it probably, I'm guessing, stays pretty low.
Right.
You know, and I'm sure it's correct for their purposes.
Right, right,
and,
right.
And if that means hands off, that's fine. You know, I don't need to go in there. It just would be nice to be able to just
sure. Pour right, well, you're right there.
Yeah, exactly. You know, just do the whole thing.
Straight
and it would keep it nice, the whole thing, too.
Well, let's,
So we had these two questions. One was, Can we put a mow the path over the 1 acre?
Yes.
You know, and then
put the walking path.
Can we put the walking path over the 1 acre around the old edge
where it used to be?
Yeah, all the way around the perimeter. Yeah.
And then can Gary oversee?
Right. That would be
no-till seed.
Yeah.
And really harvest it. I mean, maybe they wouldn't want you to harvest it. I don't know. But.
Right. And
well,
you know,
yes, and
it's fine
and
either way if that's the way they want it.
Even if it's not harvested, what maintenance plan
does it need? Right,
Yeah,
because you certainly need to
do some
rotary mow it at least once a year, minimum.
Yeah.
You know, if you're not, that's what I say. If they're going to let you do that. What's the difference?
I can show you my fields of how quickly they grow up if you don't do anything.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Awful. Everything wants to be woods.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right. So we're in agreement that right now to go forward with this. Okay. Mm-hmm. Any other questions? All right. I'll make a motion that we sign the agreement with Gary Totman to farm the property we've been discussing, which is known as the Rose Field. And we'll work out any other details after that first mowing in next June. Mm-hmm. All right.
Then we had another thing to sign.
Was it
the whole farmers agreement?
That's for Gary.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah.
So we don't sign. We sign that. We don't sign.
Yeah. Great. There's a little bit of a more complex document. The Conservation Commission wanted a map of the wetlands attached. And I had one of those, so I did that.
You did I get a second?
See that.
Did I get a second?
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
And then there's that hold harmless agreement, where you don't sue the town.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I'd just be suing myself.
Yeah, so you can see that attachment A is a map of the property.
Okay.
And there's the wetlands over there.
Yeah.
And that little bit.
Yeah, so this is basically the line
and
where that path is, where the beginning of what you can actually, and then it slopes off here.
Yeah.
I think I was with my mower. Okay, that's
you know,
probably
it's that
right
butternut
here
tree.
Where that rock is.
Yeah.
And I soon realized
then,
that's not
so
the place to be.
You'll also need to sign there.
Okay.
So there's two places for you.
Oh, and this is
just the front page.
Okay.
Yeah. And that's the new front page. Yeah, that's the new front page. So that's good.
Okay, so I'm printing and then signing?
Yeah, and one of these is your copy, and one of them's our copy.
And where's the lower hit, the lower area?
That there. That's one, and then be ours and that can be yours.
You have equipment small enough to get down there, huh?
Small enough.
Well, I think the boat is having gigantic air.
I have another hand from Janet.
No, it's no problem.
Okay, so we'll
so
just, I'll
I guess
just put
that'll
it on
have that. To be tabled
have
until
fun.
Next
okay.
week.
Thank you.
Or next meeting, which
no
is
contract.
When's your next meeting?
In 2 weeks.
I'll
so
probably talk
no
to Jack. Because yeah. when I... Okay, we should... I want to just quick show you something. Okay, so this kind of is that area where the it's hay baled off, that little
right.
yeah. oh, wet hole there,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
So this area here, that's on this side of it, that's all good to go. Mm-hmm. This here, it was fine with corn, mm-hmm. but for hay and for hay equipment, and that's probably one reason why I started up higher than mm-hmm. found I couldn't do that.
Yeah.
It would be so narrow as to almost, I don't really want to bother putting
that
seed right
there,
that,
yeah.
that little drive
yeah.
in there
yeah.
is
right.
so
I
narrow.
Right.
So if Jack, if, and you, if you guys are going to rotary mow that path around,
mm-hmm.
maybe you could take an extra couple of swipes right there in that beginning part
mm.
just to keep that
keep
from
open.
Growing. Yeah. Yeah, because
there's I mean that whole area is getting a lot of junk. It's getting
yeah.
loose strife and knotweed, yeah. and I mean it's right connected to where the highway department's
right.
been
right.
using the property, and it's a big mess. And we keep figuring, well, something different's going to happen there one of these years soon. So we haven't really
normally isn't that really wet?
On it.
I mean, normally I'm not sure you can mow there. It's so wet.
Which
oh, it's up,
on the
it's
left,
it's uphill,
not, uh-huh. up, uphill from
yeah.
that willowy spot.
It's
okay.
Right. Right now, there's areas dry enough to mow that you.
Oh, everywhere.
Right, right,
right.
But not normally.
Yeah, that's
yeah.
not
yeah.
bad.
Thank you guys for coming in.
Appreciate
great.
It.
Okay. Great.
Thank you.
Okay, next item on the agenda. I think Bob, you have to leave the discussion here.
Yes.
No, he has to not contribute to it at
yeah.
all.
Yeah.
I will. I'll
do
be happy
do
to.
Do you leave the room, Bob?
Would you like me to?
Well, I don't know. Do you think we have to?
Well, it would be best practice, but I think we can not. We can slack a little on that one.
Okay.
For this.
Do you
time.
Want to? You want to give us a rundown?
Yeah.
On what you did.
Oh.
With this?
There was some, as you know, there are fire chiefs that get they do get call outs, call out time. Our fire chief is works at a very modest stipend
mm-hmm.
For the responsibility involved, and it's an amazing thing and a remnant of an older time when people could have the time and the ability to do this. And what I view this as I do in many other areas of town governance, is I view us getting ready for the next iteration of town government, where we may actually have to pay people for doing what they do, with the exception of volunteer committees and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
But people who are actually taking on staff duties for the town, it's always been my goal to bring those people up to the level of pay which is consonant with the work that they're doing,
mm-hmm.
and this is well within the range. It is not outside the norm at all, and it also it's not as ungenerous as some other towns are, but I think given the fact that the total amount we would be spending would be somewhere between $2,000 and $3,000 a year, I don't think it is at all too much to assign for hourly pay for the chief when he's called out on when he goes on calls.
So you research the neighboring towns, and the majority of those towns give their fire chiefs call out pay. And that pay, and this is within the range of that.
I can't say comprehensively that the majority of towns give call out pay, but I think it's a best practice.
I see.
And based again on trying to move the town towards towards a budget that will survive people working for nothing, basically.
All right, so I'll make a motion that based on our town administrator's recommendation and the fact that our fire chief gets a modest stipend, that we approve a call-out rate of $25 an hour for hourly pay for the fire chief's call-outs. Do I have a second?
I'll second it.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Okay. Next item on the agenda. Okay, we have John Heffernan, who is very involved in the youth sports program, recently received a national education award called, the Presidential Award for Excellence in Math and Science Teaching, the nation's highest teaching award in the kindergarten to sixth grade category. And it was brought to our attention, and we wanted to provide a letter of recognition for John for all his good work, because he does a tremendous job with the youth sports program. And I'd just like to read the letter that we're going to send to John. The Conway Select Board commends you on your Presidential Award for Excellence in Math and Science Teaching, the nation's highest teaching award in the kindergarten to sixth grade category. If this were your only distinction, Conway would be fortunate to be your home. In addition to this, though, you have taken on difficult volunteer jobs of bringing youth baseball and basketball into the town's recreation program and have been tireless in organizing volunteers to assist in the maintenance of the ball field and advocating and working for additional resources. Your presence noticeably helps make Conway into an extraordinary town, and as we applaud your recognition as a nationally distinguished teacher, we also give you thanks and appreciation for your excellent volunteer work. Thank you very much, sincerely, and that's from the board. As I say, that's just an outstanding recognition for John and the work that he's doing. I'll make a motion that we sign this letter of commendation to John. Do I have a second? All in favor?
Aye.
You know what? I just signed a copy. I'm sorry.
Yep.
We have one on better paper.
Quite an award.
Yeah, I heard that on the news one night.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, there were two recognitions given in this local area. And I hear John's name called, and I was like, whoa.
Yeah. There's a big article in the Recorder.
Yes, yeah. All right, next item on the agenda is to sign the agreement with Michael Rainville for engineering services for highway garage repair.
Normally, this would be something done just as a matter of course in terms of building maintenance. However, since there was an agreement to be signed, I requested that it be brought to the board.
Okay.
Can we get a chance to look at that before we sign it?
Yeah.
I did read it through and didn't find anything objectionable myself.
Changed right there. It's got to be with the town of Conway, not the highway superintendent. That's the town of Conway's building, not the highway superintendent's. Right? It's the town of Conway's building, not the highway superintendent's.
There. Town of Conway.
This is going to get changed to town of Conway. Oh, it did. I see what you did. This makes it sound like he's only trying to raise one door. Is that true?
Only raise one door, yes. Others, I think, will be repaired. Is that right?
Because he talked about
one. Replaced.
Well, try to get the guy to raise the fire station and doors, too. Ron and I talked about that. Says there's only one door.
Yes, well.
On the east end of the east end of the garage.
I can't answer for that. We can always have him, we can always add to this scope of work if.
What's he calling the east end of the door? Request. Just have one on his end of the building?
One raised. He said that after he talked to him, and based on reworking the concrete, that was all that he thought was necessary. So.
Because Ron approached me about asking Ron if we would be willing to allow them to raise the doors in and make it more clearance for the fire trucks, too. Because they're like less than an inch clearance going in and out.
Well, we can add to this scope if
I mean,
we like.
Going to do it for one. The same engineering design would go from all, I would think. I mean, they're all designed the same way now.
Yeah.
Well,
and yes, this is just for the engineering. Mm-hmm. Because of the load bearing.
That's coming
capacity.
Out of that grant money?
This was a town meeting vote.
Oh, that's right. Excuse me, town meeting vote. Come on, that town meeting vote, right?
I will check with Ron about the scope of the project.
So is this just you sign this, John?
Yeah. All right, I'll make a motion that we sign the agreement between Conway and the engineer for professional services to do both repair work on the town garage. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Is that the Michael Rainville who's in Conway?
I assume it is. He's an engineer.
Yes, yeah.
I didn't realize he was an engineer.
Yeah.
Good. Nice guy.
Oh, yeah. My neighbor.
Yeah, your neighbor as well.
Okay, next item on the agenda is the Open Space Committee contract with Lori Sanders.
And we can table that. Because although we have a draft, we're not sure it's the right draft.
Okay.
We have not yet heard back from the chair of the committee on considerations that were going on over the last couple of weeks.
Okay, so we're not...
So I'll put that on the next.
Okay.
Okay.
Table. Okay.
But I do have the other item there.
Other item. Oh, yes. Okay.
Yes.
Do you want to bring that up? Or
Yes. She sent an email serving as notification of her intention to resign as assistant to the town administrator.
And we're talking about?
Becky Stone,
okay.
The assistant to the town administrator. She's negotiated a new contract with her other municipal position in Vermont and will not be available for the required number of hours needed in Conway. She's also away this week, which is something we had discussed earlier separately. She would be available to work in Conway on Fridays during the month of October, and made her resignation effective October 28th. That said, she'll be able to come in on Friday, October 14th. I don't think we would need her after that date, and I'll clarify that with her, because I have spoken with the second the person we were considering as being next in our line when we did the interviews for her, since that was only a couple of months ago.
Yeah.
And she's still interested in working for the town.
Okay.
So I would like to pursue that with her and perhaps have her come in a couple of weeks, if that's all right with you, for your meeting her and with any luck making the offer at that point.
Is that legal, John, to do?
Yeah, because we've already interviewed her in connection with the last...
I didn't know once the position was filled if you didn't have to re-advertise it all over again. I don't know.
Well, it's a part-time position, so it would be a minimal... We did more advertising than we had to last time anyway, and it only being a couple of months, within the probationary period, it didn't work out. We'll fall back on the second one. I think that would be the normal thing to do.
Yeah, I think it's expeditious as well.
Yep.
Yeah. And your second person on the list lives here in town?
She lives in Greenfield.
Okay.
So,
but she's a lot
closer than
closer.
Okay. Reedsboro.
Good. All right. Good. Tom, you have an update for us?
Yes, I do. On committee work, the Energy Committee is exploring cooperating with a new office at UMass to have them assist in the town's Mass Energy Insight computer application, as it is very involved and not entirely suitable for a volunteer committee to manage. This has to do with the Green Communities program and tracking the town's energy use. They have people who are available to help towns now, so they're exploring that. The 250th committee would like to invite a descendant of Marshall Field to the 250th anniversary as a guest of honor, and have prepared a draft of a letter for the select board to send. This is the draft. They're looking for your comments. This is Heidi Flanders. If you could email her, let's say by a week from tonight, flanders@integbuild.com. I can send that out.
Send
that.
Yeah.
And you have a digital copy of this?
I only have a PDF.
Okay.
That's what they sent.
Okay.
What's Integ? How do you spell that?
INTEG build.com. And that's Flanders at. You could also send them to me. I would forward them to Heidi. But I think if we had it in a week, then I could compile what I have. You can send it directly to her. We can get any, and then they can work on a final draft. Get it back to me. I can put it on town letterhead. Have it for you by the next select board meeting.
Okay.
For departmental updates, the Highway Superintendent, his assistant, and I have been coordinating on hiring a new laborer. We are almost ready to post an ad. Just going over finalizing that ad. And also from my own desk, the revised community development strategy is set for review on Wednesday, two evenings from tonight, 7 o'clock, Town Hall. Come one, come all. It'll be fun. Mm-hmm. And it would be great to have a number of people show up.
Okay.
For project updates, the South River project is awaiting final sign-off by the engineer and then the Conservation Commission. After that, there will still be a final cleanup of the area to be completed no later than November 1st. The Town Hall insulation project is on hold, at least the exterior part of it, while we supply some information to the Massachusetts Historical Commission. They need the elevations and photographs and the specs. Apparently, state agencies are supposed to notify the Mass Historical Commission when funds are used in historic districts. And this has not been a part of the Green Communities program. So Conway is once again setting a precedent, though this time in a direction we did not anticipate. The highway superintendent and I met with the engineer for the Delabar Avenue project, who was preparing an appeal to FEMA for grant funding. At the very least, we'll know whether it will be eligible in the future. At best, it could be funded this year, though this is unlikely. The Energy Committee hosted a meeting with several committee and board representatives to outline an ownership proposal for their proposed community solar project. Preliminary indications are that a town-owned project would be very worthwhile. Many communities choose to have a private company own and maintain such projects, but according to the Energy Committee's consultant, there is a substantial financial benefit to town ownership, even accounting for operation and maintenance. With this preliminary understanding, the Energy Committee will be having a larger meeting of multiple boards, including the Select Board, to explain the proposal. They're planning this now for the last Tuesday in October. So the day after our, no, not after our next meeting, it's on an off week for us.
That's Tuesday in October, huh?
It's the 25th?
Yes, and that would be at 7.
7 p.m.?
Actually, I think it's at 6.
Well, that is when they met this time. I'm not sure they...
Well, they were planning two meetings they were going to have.
Well, one was going to be at 7 and one was going to be at 6, wasn't it?
This one was at 6 and then the larger meeting was going to be at 7.
Larger meeting coming up on the 25th. This is the larger
meeting. This is the larger meeting. Okay.
So that would be at 7 probably. But we'll hear about that well in advance. I'll get all that out to you, along with the information that we have from the consultant. And finally,
the larger meeting was going to be on November 15th.
Oh, we have two meetings.
And that one was at 7.
Oh, okay. So who's going to the October 25th meeting then?
I think it's more of a working meeting.
All right, there's another meeting November 15th.
Yep.
We'll see.
What's that for?
Which one all the boards go to. It's the Energy Committee with their... Okay, thank you. Thank you. I was actually counting on you reporting on that meeting, and you didn't. No,
sorry. We went round and round.
Yes, it's true, we did, and... I was somewhat confused, apparently. Letter from Lynn Carey, the new superintendent of Frontier Regional High School. We, in 2004, apparently, Article 7, town allocated $627,000, the town's share of a total $65,000 appropriation, for re-roofing and making other necessary repairs to the school's central office building. Of that amount, $6,447.08 remains in the custody of the Frontier Regional School District. So they only spent about $4,200.
Is that the building that they're leaving?
This is the building that they're leaving. Mm-hmm. So at this time, the funds are needed to relocate the central office to the Frontier Regional Middle High School. Because funds are needed for a project different from its original purpose, we need the member town's authorization to utilize those funds to relocate. Therefore, the committee is requesting an article be placed on the warrant to allow for this modification. So I will put this in the tickler file for whatever next town meeting we have.
Right.
And right now, we don't have anything that would push having a special town meeting.
Mm-hmm.
We do have that possibility of a resolution regarding ballot question two. This is the second item that we might have. I'm not sure that either of those in themselves are worth having a special town meeting for.
Is there a rush on getting this money
repurposed? I will ask about that.
I think I bet they're funding it out of their general funds right now, but they just want clarifications in there.
It's there for paperwork.
Yeah. And
they've already started that.
Right.
If we did this by the end of the fiscal year, they would be able to use this money.
Okay.
So I will respond that we will put it on our next town meeting warrant, but we're not sure when that's going to be.
Yeah. Okay.
And that's all I have.
Okay. Thank you, Tom. Concerns of the selectmen? We have any concerns, gentlemen?
No.
No? Okay. Mail, I don't see any mail that is particularly relevant.
I don't know, a piece of mail here. Did you guys get the letter from the, or did it just dressed to me, from the, Regional Transit Authority?
Yeah.
No, that was for you.
It was an invite you sent to me, because member of the group. I'd just like to explain this to you. I'll read it to you. The Franklin Regional Transit Authority, the Franklin Regional and the Franklin Regional Council of Governments are pleased to invite you to the dedication of our meeting room in remembrance and honor of our friend and dedicated board member, William B. Allen III. He used to be the county engineer. He was one of the last county engineers we had, not the very last one. He was very helpful to me for over the years. When I was highway superintendent for most of my years, we're dealing with road problems and stuff in the county and stuff like that. But they're having it on October 27th at 2 p.m. and I hope to attend that. But to dedicate the meeting hall there, because he was a great pusher for getting that building put where it is and stuff like that.
I knew him through the regional planning
very,
board.
Very, very nice
and
man.
He's
a fantastic man.
Very nice, and he knew everything. Road in the county, like he lived on it.
Yeah, he did.
Unbelievable.
So I just want to let you know that I'll be going to that.
Okay, terrific. Okay, next meeting is scheduled for October 17th at 7 o'clock here in the town office. We're not going to have an executive session tonight. So I'll make a motion that we adjourn. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.